Kyle Rideout.
Hi.
We got a desk and everything.
No, wow.
Keith wanted to impress you. I was gonna bring a TV tray. And one of those pillows that just has the flat laptop on the front. Remember those?
I remember those.
Yeah, they were extendable beanbags that kept all the heat around your waist and made everything uncomfortable.
Yeah, those are good. Well, I think this is nice. It's a nice table. Talk a little bit about Thorax.
Hi.
We're very glad to have you out here. So are there other convention appearances lined up for you after this? And did you reach out to them or did they reach out to you?
There might be some more in the works.
Okay.
Yeah. I didn't reach out to their people, but...
Oh, they will find you.
Yeah.
If you are on IMDb, they can find you. If YouTube has taught me anything.
Yeah.
So we were talking earlier today, and this is kind of your premier kind of debutante ball, if you will, coming out to the fandom and the fans, and we can't thank you enough for making the journey out here.
Yeah.
So I kind of wanted to learn a little bit about, before we turn it over to Q&A, just a little bit about yourself or career coming up in acting.
Yeah.
Did you study in school for, when did you get bit by the theater bug?
I saw a show when I was 16, Cabaret, at the school called Studio 58, which is in Vancouver. And I was very, very shy in high school and growing up. And I felt I needed theater to get out of my own little shell. So I saw Cabaret and I just knew I had to go to this school. And so they auditioned across Canada and they took 16 people. So I got into that school and it was a 3-year program. And then right after that, I started working in theater. So I started in Shakespeare and a lot of plays and then started getting into film and TV and voiceover.
Were you one of those kids that was always singing or always playing stuff with, playing with your hands or playing with action figures, creating your own scenes and dialogues? There are photos of my growing up of various Mighty Max and Battle Trolls, if anyone remembers those from the 90s, just tableaus all across my bureaus and drawers, and every week someone else would be on the ground covered in a ketchup packet.
Similar. Yeah, I wasn't singing songs. I was pretty shy, a little bit in front of my family, but I did do G.I. Joes, a little bit older. I was very much in my own world, in my own imagination. I spent a lot of time drawing and doing artwork as well, and that, I think, influenced my desire to start directing and get into filmmaking, which I also have recently been doing a lot of.
Yeah, let's get into that transition.
Yeah.
So how long were you on stage, just specifically Vancouver or East and West Coast of Canada?
It was mainly West Coast, but there's some shows that went across Canada that we toured.
How long were you on stage before you stepped into TV and movies? Is that something that you initiate yourself or someone reaches out to you?
Yes, it's a combination of both. An agent is interested in working with you and it's a bit of a collaboration between the two and they help you get work. So I had an agent for some time and then I started to really pursue doing more film and TV. And Vancouver, if you may have heard, is a great city with a lot of American shows that come up and Canadian shows.
Oddly enough, a show called Supernatural, which two hunters go across the U.S. and have yet never left the Pacific Northwest.
Right. And I was on that one. Supernatural. Supernatural. I was on... I don't know.
Okay.
I can't remember. A few years ago.
Background, or you just got stabbed and you were off?
I got killed in that one.
Okay.
Yeah, I got killed.
Is that sort of like the Canadian CSI, where every actor has been on there as either a villain or a killable off extra? It's on year 12.
Yeah, I mean a lot of casting happens down in LA for some of the bigger roles, but that's what's so great about Vancouver is you're able to get into some of these bigger shows and start building your resume to bigger parts. I just did a guest star on iZombie.
Yep.
Great
show.
Very large recurring part on this new show called The Arrangement, which is really exciting.
The arrangement, what is that on?
That's on E, and it's about, well, you should check it out. It's coming out in April, and I think it's kind of a high fashion show, and it's about a high-profile action star who marries, they have an arranged marriage with another actress, and then it details the dynamics of that relationship. So
I was hoping to talk a little bit about the transition of, so when you're trained on stage as a theater actor, it's not just your voice you're using, it is everything. Face is giving expression, body expression is adding on to that, you're playing to an audience. But then you get into a booth, and there's no one save for the director, maybe the sound recorder.
Yeah.
Was that an interesting transition for you, getting into animation? Like, suddenly, your whole body and tool set is completely limited to your throat.
Yeah, it was a bit of a transition, just learning, you know, how to work with a mic, and how to focus the acting into you know, the imagination. A lot of times, you know, I'm imagining what's kind of happening in the scene, so, you know, and also you see a lot of voice actors using their body because it just adds more to the voice when their body is engaged. But you have to have it engaged in kind of this weird robotic way where you keep your head very centered towards the mic. So it just kind of got, you know, you got used to it, and
they just send you up with a neck brace, they'll let your arms go wherever you need
exactly.
to.
Exactly, just hold you on right
Don't
there.
Leave from the pop screen, this is your
yeah.
friend.
Yeah.
Who is in the room with you at that point? Is it ever a table read-around for an episode, or do they bring in the actors individually? Because then the editors will just put the lines together later.
I'm trying to remember for Thorax, for My Little Pony, I can't remember if they recorded me separately, but normally we always do it in the room. We don't do a table read. We don't practice ahead of time. We just come into the room and we just start going. You start line one, and they'll run a whole scene, and they get to the end of the scene, and then they give little notes on each couple of lines, and then they're moving on. So usually you get maybe two times you get to say the line, maybe three. So it goes very quick. But it's great to play off of everyone in the room. And I was on Littlest Pet Shop, and so a lot of the MLP, there's a lot of people on that we work together. And so, and it was in the same recording studio. Yeah.
So getting into the lovable changeling that kind of crossed lines to become almost a sympathetic villain, and then hero into his own, Thorax.
Yeah.
When you were handed the sides, did you already have the character ready to go, or did you work alongside the director to develop where the voice was going to come from?
We always have to come up with our own voices, and we send it in. And that one, I was away on vacation up in Vernon. It's about a 4-hour drive from Vancouver.
You went even northern in Canada?
Even north. I mean, Vancouver's right around the border, too. And I did an audition, and I actually did it. My mom makes quilts. She's a big quilter. And I was in her closet where she had all these amazing quilts, and I was doing it in there, and it was like the perfect closet because you know, it absorbs all the sound, so it sounds really, really good. But I felt like it was because I had my mom's love. But I did about five different voices. I'm trying to remember what the other ones were.
One was kind of, you know, just really kind of stuttery.
And then there was, yeah, and then the actual Thorax voice was this one. And so I just, you know, sent it in and tried to embody the character of a shy changeling and put it in.
Yeah. When you were working on this developing, did you have an image of the character already from the animators? Or they just said, he's tiny and shy, go?
Basically tiny and shy. Yeah, we don't normally...
I hope he's cute like everything else on the show. My daughter loves it.
Yeah, exactly. You don't normally get...
It's like a dried out spider.
Yeah. When you audition for a new series, they'll often have character sketches. And they give it, you know, so you can have an idea of the character, which really helps. For Littlest Pet Shop, I saw pictures of Vinny before reading for that character. Yeah.
You can't tell me if he's coming back next season, can you?
No.
That's fine. Tell if he's coming back.
That's fine. I couldn't either because I don't work on the show. So.
Yeah. I miss him. I always miss hearing his voice, too.
Hey there. Anyone listen to Vinny? The Liz Pet Shop. Wow. Okay. Yeah.
So, in addition to transitioning to voice acting, there's a film that you've also directed. We've done a lot of stuff on TV. Did you ever direct in theater first and then kind of, because when you step into directing, you are the focal length for all the talent going into a film. Were you directing in theater first, or I think it's Edward was the film that you directed.
Yeah, I really have had a passion for making film for a long time, and I had already been acting for some time, and I was wanting to get into filmmaking, and I talked to people and they said, you know what, you need to go out and make a short. So I went out and made a short as my film education instead of going to a school, because I, you know, I was already, you know, 26, 27 at the time. I didn't feel like I had the time to go in for 4 years. So I made a short and it ended up winning Best Short in Canada on the CBC. Mm-hmm. And I got $40,000 to put into another movie. So I put that into this film called Edward, which is a period drama about the godfather of cinema. He's a photographer who took kind of risky photos at the time of people that were nude doing movements, because he was trying to document human movement. And he also killed his wife's lover and is one of the last Americans to get justifiable homicide. So it stars Sarah Canning from Vampire Diaries, and what else is she? Oh, she's in Lemony Snicket right now. And
she'll hopefully live through the end of it.
She lives through it, not her lover. I know, spoiler alert. So yeah, I went and made that film and it did really well. It just was released down here in the US. 50 million homes. I think it's on iTunes and Time Warner and I don't know, a lot of different outlets. And and then we started another movie called Public School with Judy Greer from
Archer. My first love of her.
I was talking to another person and they mentioned Archer and Arrested Development. And also Russell Peters stars in it, the comedian. And that will be coming out next year.
Now transitioning, there is homework to do as an actor, but then when you transition into directing, you have to be up and around for 24/7. Did you leave that experience thinking it was harrowing, like after a marathon, never again? Or did that just energize you from seeing the production side?
Yeah, it did energize me, but it is really, really challenging. And I really do feel that the actor, you know, we have such a great job. Like, it does feel like the easier job. Like, even with MLP, I know that there goes into, like, the planning of the episode, the writing, and all the producing and production, and we show up for a four-hour session.
And then you go home.
And then we go home. So, on the flip side of it, when I'm directing and writing and producing and getting the, you know, financing of a film, and then to the point where actors show up is, like, you know, 2 years later, and they show up for 10 days or whatever for the shoot, and then they head out, and now I continue to work with this project for another year. But I still enjoy doing all that because I get to create the whole thing. Mm-hmm. On the movie, when we were shooting it, you know, there were so many people on the crew, and I came walking in to the set, and it was like, because of me and the writing partner, we had this idea, it now created jobs for all these people, and they were able to come into it. So it was really exciting in that way to be able to create this big thing.
And suddenly you have people doing lighting, people doing makeup, people catering, someone else is scheduling that entire different division of it. Someone is scheduling the scheduling people to show up for that.
Yeah.
And then in addition, you also have to sit on the stage and make sure you've got exactly the image that you're going for in your head.
Yeah.
We're gonna jump back into MLP in just a moment, but I wanted to give kudos to a project I saw you in last February when it premiered. I think the greatest romantic comedy Marvel has ever put out. You are in Deadpool, sir.
Yes, I am in Deadpool. Yeah, so that actually happened because I didn't go out for the original round of casting, and then my agent's like, they're doing pickups, so they're doing reshoots on some of it. So I shot it. It came out in February, and I shot that in December. I have a really a small part in it. If, I think if you blink, I think I'm in the trailer too, but I'm one of the people that gets killed.
Oh,
but
I'm sensing a theme.
Yeah. I know.
I think they put a black line.
Yeah.
Is that a different kind of energy or commitment? Is showing up and doing and getting in the scene, taking it again and again, versus you are rehearsing for on stage, but at stage, you do the play and then you kind of leave at the end of the day. Is that a different, even a different schedule or a different energy when you're doing on-shoot television and film to doing stage work?
Yeah, they are all very different kind of energies and beasts. So with theater, you know, with a Shakespeare show, you have to really be mentally prepared, really physically warmed up, and you have to keep that for, you know, we did 100 shows of Romeo and Juliet, like, over a summer, so it, you know, to keep that endurance of that performance and still keep it fresh is always the challenge. And then when you come to film, it's like so instant. You have to wait around for a long time. With Deadpool, I think I was on set for like 14 hours. They did, you know, 20 camera angles, and I'm in the movie for 2 seconds. So it's a different kind of endurance where, yeah, you have to sit there for 14 hours, but then when they're ready to go, you need to dive in and be really energetic and you know, keep nailing it for every take. And then working with the director to make adjustments. But then every single thing you do, you have to exactly remember when you touched it, at what point you do a thing to your hair in the wide shot, and then you have to be aware of when they're moving in closer for the different shots. And now you're like, oh, when did I do the things that I was doing and the lines that I was saying?
Because one continuity error and the internet will hate you forever.
Yeah, that's your job as the actor to remember how you do it.
Or in some cases, just name a pony without the director's consent and then just end up making it in the second season. I'm looking at you, Derby.
Yeah. So, yeah, and then voiceover is a totally different beast where it feels like you never should be doing the same thing twice. Like when you say a line, then when you go back to say the line again, you need to bring something else fresher to it. You keep needing to bring freshness to everything that you're doing and saying.
Nerdier, slower, sadder.
Yeah.
Did you feel that it was much more hands-on working with a film director than working one-on-one with an animation director?
As myself as a director? Oh, as an actor working with a director?
Yeah,
I think there's much more hands-on with an animation director than a film or TV director. Often with TV directors, they're cinematographers, which is the person in charge of the lighting and the camera. And so someone like that, if they're directing, they don't have the language of actors. And so they spend a lot more time just working on the camera angles. And then they when they do give their notes, they're very nice to you, instead of a director who knows actors that we can change and we're not gonna be crying or upset if you go, oh, no, that doesn't work, try something else. And we're like, great. But when you get one of those directors that is not as actor friendly, they'll be like, hi, okay, so try, what you're doing is good, I think we just need another.
Here's your gold sticker.
Yeah, exactly.
You'll get another.
Yeah.
If you put in a Swedish accent this time, can you do that for me?
Yeah, and it's almost like they're intimidated to come up and just and give you notes of saying, that's not working, try this. Okay, that didn't work, try that. And, you know, we're able to do that. We're constantly being given notes all the time to adjust our performance.
Did you find that coming in to help you, of coming with a lifetime of being on stage and using your body? Because so people get in and they'll do their own fan-dubs of pony episodes, or they'll want to do their own singing, or they want to do their own voiceover work, but they've not been on stage before or gotten exposure before. Is there any advice that you would want to give to someone who wants to eventually get into voice acting? Start doing that, or act in different mediums?
Like, which one should you start in? Well, I think theater is like always the the roots of, you know, you look at some of the great film actors and voiceover actors, and they've started in the theater. So I would say start in the theater. You're working all the muscles that you use in film and all the muscles you use in voiceover. But when you move into film, you drop a lot of the muscles, and but you use less of the colors that you do in theater, and you're just making it a little bit more focused. And then with voiceover, it's the same thing. The audience isn't seeing your body and all that work that you need to do of, you know, creating blocking for your character. And so I think theater is the root. And when I did my very first voiceover, it was the Littlest Pet Shop. No, it was Packages from Planet X, a show for Disney XD. And I knew that you had to have a lot of energy, so I had 3 espressos. And I was like, because I also know that there's not a lot of patience for mistakes. You need to be on. And
good, so you had caffeine and nerves to go off.
Yeah, I was like, I'm ready to go here. All right. And another voice actor who I'm great friends with now, he was voicing the lead character, and the people were online down in LA. And I think they are trying to really get the sense of this character for the first time. So I think he got around 50 notes to readjust his line about 50 times. And I was like, and that's not normally the case. And I was kind of having a little panic attack. I'm like, oh my gosh, if this is what voiceover is like, this is gonna be insane. Like to have the director 50 times being like, oh, try it, like, or like a little like an ad like that here. And the tip for, and he was like exhausted of doing the voice over and over and over. And yeah, that was my first time. But then after that line, they got the sense of the character, and then they were able to move on. But I was like,
So we've mentioned before, this is your first time coming out and guesting at a PonyCon, and I'm hoping some of the other actors prepped you for what you're in for the kind of generosity and the kind of smiles, just the reception from the fans. Have you gotten gifts yet?
I got a couple of gifts. I got 2 gifts.
This is your first, when did you get a gift? This is your first day.
I know.
On the job.
I know.
Dang it, I'm in the wrong field. What did you get?
I got a carving from Ed of Thorax in both his changeling form and in his unchangeling form. And then a nice poster, a beautiful poster. So yeah, I feel very honored to be here. I'm very excited, and then I'm excited for the weekend of hanging out and having a good time.
Ashley's trying to work you through what happens when someone reveals their character tattoo, their right reaction. Art is good! Good for you. No, I don't want one myself. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Would you like to open up to some questions?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Sweet. I'm going to take a seat at the front of the stage. If there's anything that you want to ask Kyle about working on the show or making a living as an actor, director out in Vancouver, be my guest. I'm going to take my mic so we can hear the question. How does my... had directing work. That was your test. And I did not pass. And that's as far as I think I'm going to go. Oh, now it's...
You got some more.
I can handle both. This is what professionals do. Break everything the tech crew hands them. So if there's anything that's one... Come on up. Good afternoon, my friend. What's your name? Where are you from?
Nick. I'm from Bayville, New Jersey, down south.
Hey.
I'm a university student. I go to school, actually. Trying to make it as a writer, director, aspiring.
Cool.
Yeah. That which I wanted to ask you, since you have directing work and an acting work, I wanted to know what it is as an actor you look for in a director. Like some, an attribute or quality or a type of directing that you can look at this person and go, okay, we're on the same page. I appreciate
right.
it.
Like from an actor's point
from
of view.
From an actor's point of view.
What do I look like
yes.
from a director?
Yeah, how can you tell a good director from a bad director?
Well, that's a hard question. But because as an actor, I mean, I'm always just looking for work, so I'm not necessarily looking to be like, oh, if that's a good director.
I've heard that.
Oh,
I've heard that.
Yeah, okay. But, so we're always looking for work, but a good director, Terry Clausen on NLP is a really good voice director. He's very, he keeps really good schedule, he's very casual, but he's really precise in what he wants. So there's an essence about that that's like a good mix for directing. And as for film and TV, it's about having someone that doesn't start making, if it's not oversharing how you're feeling. You know, if you work with a director who's quite uptight or nervous or trying to get stuff done, it starts to create that for the whole group of people. But you know, what's great about Terry is he comes in, he's very confident, he's collected his thoughts on what he wants to do with it, he knows the material really well, so he's prepared, but he's not nervous about it or, you know, intense about what he's of trying to get this master vision. You know, once he gets what he likes, he's like ready to move on. Good, okay, let's move on. Is that helpful?
It is. So do you appreciate directors that let you as an actor contribute to the project in your own way?
That which? That light me?
Light. Oh. Contribute to the project in your own way.
Directors that are open to having the actor share in their own voice.
Yeah, like maybe it's not exactly what he was looking for, but wow, you just did this thing that just changed the whole plan. Do you appreciate that?
Yeah, I think the actor's job is to come with as many ideas as possible. And the director's job is to pick which ones work as a collaborator. And when I'm directing my films, like talking with, like Judy Greer came to the table with so many wonderful ideas. She's like, hey, this line here. And I was like, yeah, that's a great idea. No, this one, I don't know if we need that idea. But this, you know, and I think someone that's collaborative is immensely important as a director. And acting classes, if you haven't taken acting classes,
it's actually a course requirement.
Yeah, because they make you do that. I think you need to do even more than just that. And I'm really happy that I went into the acting route, into directing, because I can talk to actors and I know the language and the lingo.
Does fighting for your objective sound familiar?
Yeah. But it's even more simpler than objective, but yeah.
Well, thank you very much. That's why you're my help.
All right, good luck.
Come on up. That's a nice statement about just the communal, coming from improv comedy, we're trained, rule number one is yes and, always build off of someone else's idea. And it can be so much more fun when actor and director are collaborating together. So that's all that. What's your name, where are you from, my friend?
I'm Matthew from Long Island. I was wondering, because a changeling can change their voice when they change their persona or whatever, they change into like a pony or something, was there ever any like decision on when you change forms until you're like, I guess your king role now, to change your voice?
Right. This is the number one question I've gotten so far here. Because I know it ends with Thorax not talking. I don't know. I can't tell you. I don't know.
Could there be any creative freedom that they said that you might be able to do that? Or do you think you're just going to use the same voice?
I feel like they would be the same. I don't know.
Because to me, I feel like the
shot of the voice. Go on, we're able to do a full-on Jerry Lewis impression.
Yeah, well, maybe he sounds like Owen Wilson. Wow.
I would be really happy.
What? Wow. That's amazing. What? You can't even really talk louder than this is Owen. I just can't, right? Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Wow.
Hey, King.
What's your name? Where are you from?
Alicia. I'm from Norwalk. Connecticut.
It's another state in America, guys. It's a little further north. More white, if you can imagine.
When you're in a cartoon, how do you feel when your character has emotions?
Okay, good question. How do I feel when my character has emotions? I try to feel the emotions. So, hi,
So it's Thorax, and I'm trying to talk to somebody, but I'm feeling kind of nervous. I just start to, I don't know, feel a little nervous. But then if I'm feeling really good, then it kind of makes me feel really good.
So, yeah, I mean, you kind of go along, but when you do get, I mean, I don't feel sad after the session if I've done like a sad line or something like that. For something that gets a little bit deeper, when I was doing Romeo and Juliet, that summer I did it over an entire summer, the director was like, I want real emotions. And so I was really sad all summer, and I'm like, why am I so sad? It's like, oh, right, I'm crying all the time.
Now, who was this in Romeo and Juliet, if I may ask?
What was that?
Who were you in Romeo and Juliet, if I may ask?
Romeo. Romeo.
Of course you were. Look at those eyes. What? Does anyone else have a question? What up, my friend? Yep. By the way, she and her family were some of the first in line right after opening ceremonies for this panel. Yeah, I lost it. What's your name? Where are you from, Amiga?
Robert Carnell. I have come all the way up here from Florida.
Ah.
Because I am staff at Derpy Guru. We're going to be having a panel tomorrow at 2 o'clock. Be sure to come in and see us. But my question for you, something I've always found fascinating in the acting field is when something goes kind of off the rails, but they end up leaving it in anyway. Like in A Wonderful Life, where I forget which character it is exiting the stage, and you hear a crash, then they knocked over a garbage can, they say, oh, I'm all right. In your experience in theater and movies, how often does that kind of thing happen? And have you ever experienced anything like it yourself?
Yeah, that does happen. And in my theater school, my teacher told me that's a gift. That's like this little gift that happens because it's actually the most realistic thing. Your cup falls over, and the way you grab it and pick it up is instinct. It's not acting or thought or pretend or anything. So when things go wrong, it's like this perfect gift. In my movie, Judy Greer is amazing at that. And same as our lead, Daniel Doney. You know, she was putting on something, a bow tie, and she's saying her line, and then in the middle of her line, she's like, oh, this thing. And then she keeps going with the line, and it's right in the middle of the line, and that, the editor just sent me some footage, and that take was in there, and it's so perfect because it's not perfect, because it's realistic. And on a little funny story, on Romeo and Juliet, we had these torches, and this is when it doesn't go well, and there were these little cubes that were on fire, and they were in these torches, and they were told that they were secure, and they went off to the party, and they were cheering, and I was the last one off, and I saw one of the cubes fly out and land on our wood stage, and I was like, ooh, but the audience couldn't see it, because it was behind this banister, so I was like, oh, maybe I'll just kick it off, and we'll, like, get it out, or whatever, so I'm on stage, still acting, and there's like a little flaming cube down by my feet, and then I kick it, and it breaks into 100 flaming pieces on the stage. So I run off, Juliet's about to run on, looking beautiful, and I'm like, there's a fire on the stage! And so they sprayed it with fire extinguisher, and there's smoke all over, and the party scene, everyone was confused why the floor was smoky and slippery.
Exalt Romeo entered Flame Princess.
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thanks for being here. Hi. What's your name? Where are you from?
Brianna, and I am from Connecticut. How did you get into voiceover?
How did I get into voiceover? I was acting in the Shakespeare Company, and one of my friends started working in X-Men. And I was like, oh, that's an avenue I haven't even considered, and I'd love to do it. And
it's worked great for Hugh Grant over Hugh Jackman over the last 20 years. I could be an X-Man.
Yeah. And so I talked to my agent and tried to get, you have to get a separate voice agent. So I just have a film and TV agent. I have a voice agent now. And then you also have one for just writing. But I took class with Kathy Weslock, So with Spike. Isn't that funny? And so
Was she teaching the class or was she in the class with you?
She was teaching the class.
Okay.
It was a private lesson. She did teach classes, but since I already knew so much about acting, I just wanted to come in with some very specific questions and work with some of my voices. So yeah, I did a private lesson with her, and then, you know, sometime later started working. So yeah, that's how I got in.
Do you think that it helped that do you think that she helped put in the good word with your agent, or that was just part of the training?
I don't think she put in a good word, and I don't think that helps.
Because she does know a pony that can get you in through the back door.
I know, yeah.
Namely, all.
Yeah. I think it's about just, I really think getting the roots in theater, and, you know, it was a 3-year conservative style training program, and then I'd already started acting in professionally for 5 years in theater, and then I started to try to do voice. And so I think, you know, having all that as a combination.
I loved it. So we had, you've had the Fluttershy plushie all night. I'm just distracted by that. Favorite pony. What's your name? Where are you from?
I'm Alana, and I'm from Williamsport, Pennsylvania.
So Pennsylvania is, I'm not going to do this. What's your question for Kyle?
I went to Pennsylvania. I went to research Edward, because that's where he did some of his photographs. So I went there, went to Reading Station, had one of those famous sandwiches. They were delicious.
What's your question for Kyle?
Do you ever feel like you're part of the fandom? Like you're really interested in My Little Pony, that you're like becoming one of these people?
One of these people! Anyone offended by that? That's brilliant. Welcome.
Yeah.
She can get away with it. She's part of us.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say, like, I'm very, I felt so honored when I recorded Thorax, like, a year and a half ago, maybe, or even over a year ago. And I was excited, and I knew about the fandom, because when I was doing Littlest Pet Shop, I knew Peter New was always like, I'm heading out, I'm going here, I'm going there. And so, yeah, it's kind of like an exciting adventure to go on. And I'm always someone that likes something new. And so this is like, it is very new to me. Like, this is my first one. I mean, I've heard a lot about it, but I haven't experienced it, so it's kind of an exciting, fun thing.
Oh, there is time to collect stories. This is only Friday afternoon.
Oh boy. In a world.
How are we doing on time? Oh wow, that's much longer than I thought we were. Do we have any other questions? Come on up. Let's form up a line. There were a couple of hands at that point. So you're going to start off on this row, and then just behind if I get one person next to a chair so I know how many questions that we have coming up. Thank you so much for making it up. What's your name? Where are you from?
Charles, from New Jersey in the Pine Barrens.
Hello.
I'm sorry.
Yes, I survived toxic waste.
Congratulations on getting out.
My question is to you, since you have the writer-director mindset as well, what do you think Thorax's story should be from here on in?
Oh,
I see actor canon. Put him right on the spot with that piece of
person. Oh, man.
You put it into this.
Yeah. I think Thorax should take over the whole show.
so you're in favor of the Grimdark.
Yeah.
Lead the rebellion.
Yeah, lead the rebellion.
Change is coming to Equestria.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's a hard question. I'm always just like, I'm amazed at what they've done with the show. I love the world that they've created, and that there is so much world to it. So I'm happy to go along for the ride. So I don't know how much I can add. Thank you, though.
Same question. What's your name? Where you're from? We'd love to meet you.
Hi, I'd rather not actually use my real name, but I'm Wingbeat Pony, and I'm from Pennsylvania.
What was it?
Wingbeat.
Wingbeat.
Okay, Pegasus. So my question is, as a voice actor, do you use specific words and phrases to sometimes get into a voice, and if so, what are some of the ones that you use?
Huh, like what do you mean? Like a word's a phrase?
Like for instance,
like I'll say a word.
And that'll help get you into the
Yes, voice. I do. I do that. So often when I send in my MP3s, I'll say the character. So I do a character on PBS show Ready, Jet, Go. Yeah, I played the dad on that.
So it's his Carrot. That's Carrot. So he kind of sounds like this. And I'm on. And there's this one line that I said in the MP3.
And then they play you that ref when you're first going into the series. So you hear that line a couple of times until you say it. And that's where he said I was mowing the roof. So sometimes in the middle of it, or when we haven't recorded for a while and I've done a bunch of, you know, Thorax type characters, I come in and I'm like,
I'm just mowing the roof. Yep, mowing the roof. Here I am. Okay, here we go. Yep, there we go. Mowing the roof.
Or Thorax, it's always hiya, hiya. Okay, yeah. Yeah, so that's Thorax. Hiya. I don't know why. And sometimes it's Thorax, and sometimes I say the name of the character. I'm trying to think. Oh, there's some other characters, but I can't mention those yet.
All right, thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Josh.
Hey.
I'm Jersey. Yeah. You have, your career has been so varied. I mean, it's really impressive already, in front and behind the camera. Kid shows to real dramas. What are some inspirations that you've had in your life, through in your career and in your life?
And like people that I look up to?
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, working with Judy was amazing. And also working with Michael Eklund. So he was the lead of Edward. He's in Dirk Gently right now. He's part of the Fearsome Five or the Rascal Three or something. I can't remember what they're called. Anyways, actors of that level they just really shine. When he came on set, he's always in character, just all these little mannerisms that he would do, and I would learn so much. And then as well, when Judy came to my project, that was a big step up of working with someone at that level. And the way that she worked on set, I just learned so much. Worked on and off set. There's the whole thing of how you work off set too, of just, you know, hanging out with the cast and the director and stuff. But, you know, she's just so lovely and great to work with. In the directing side, I like a lot of French-Canadian directors right now, like Denis Villeneuve, who directed Arrival. And then Jean-Marc Vallée, who did Dallas Buyers Club. You watch their filmmaking and it's very inventive, and Denis Villeneuve is very like realistic and grounded. So people like that are very inspiring. Jason Reitman.
Anybody from your childhood?
Pardon?
Anybody from your childhood?
Anyone from my childhood that I looked up, I feel like Roald Dahl I really looked up to. I'm in that world of like magic and like humor I adored. And I feel like Harry Potter kind of took some of that, a little flavor of that life, you know, and living in the under the stairs. It felt kind of like something from James and the Giant Peach.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Ed from Long Island.
Hey, Ed.
All right, it's like a two-part question because it follows the second part.
Sweet!
Okay,
sure.
First part, how knowledgeable are you about the fandom of Bronies?
I would say I'm 20% knowledgeable.
Okay!
Okay.
He passed.
And I really do mean I, as well as 20% cooler, I do feel like I'm about 20% knowledgeable. So it's a learning curve for me, and it's been exciting to learn about, but also knowing, you know, Ashley and Peter and working with them lots, I've heard lots about the fandom, and so yeah, but I've been learning new stuff this whole trip. It's been amazing. Yeah.
The reason why I'm asking, and also how much of the show have you seen there?
How much of the show have I seen? I think I've seen mainly, my daughters are watching the show a lot. So I can't tell you which episodes exactly, but.
They're just giving you notes. Daddy, don't ever be nice to griffins.
Yeah.
There is a reason why I'm asking.
Right.
This does,
oh, that makes sense.
Make sense.
All right.
The reason why I'm asking, what will you take from the show and or the fandom that you will keep with you 100 years into the future?
I think what the most amazing thing about the fandom is permission. There's permission to be yourself. Really, really, truly how you feel and who you want to be. I think that is very, very clear. And that, as an actor, is so freeing to just go through and not worry about what people think.
Thank you. So we'll touch base in another 100 years.
All right.
Hi, Kyle.
Hi.
I'm Ron. We met at the office. I'm from Brooklyn.
Yeah.
I traveled. Yeah. My question is, you've also kind of brought this up a little bit. You're constantly looking for work, you say.
Yeah.
How do you deal with it, and how do you feel if someone says your character is dying, or your character is not going to be appearing, or your character is going to be there but not speak? Like, for example,
like Deadpool,
no,
Supernatural.
Like, say, God forbid, Thorax has no lines at all, but he's just on screen. How
right.
do you feel like if you're technically there but not, or unable to work, or just the character's
yeah.
gone from screen?
I think all actors are like, oh, like always a little bit, because we are constantly looking for work. And when I'm watching a show, and you know, another show that I'm not in or a part of, and all of a sudden they come back, the character comes back, I'm always like, oh, that actor's really happy right now.
Or what if you get replaced, and how do you feel about that?
Pardon?
What if you get replaced, and then how do you feel about that? How do you deal with this?
Oh gosh, I don't know. I'd be sad.
Has your corpse ever been replaced?
Yeah. No, it hasn't.
No, I mean,
okay.
It hasn't.
Like, we don't know what Thorax is going to sound like next season. I'm worried. What if Kyle gets replaced?
Aren't we all?
So, that was my question. Thank you.
Oh, no more.
All right.
Hello, my name is Chris. I'm from South Carolina. In one episode, Tabitha St. Germain had to do an intentionally poor accent, an intentionally poor Southern accent, and I was just wondering, what would you consider, like, a most difficult technique, something like that, and how do you work on it?
Yeah, a most difficult technique. I can't say what this is for, but just last week, I had to do, I was almost do the voice there. I had to do a character that then imitated other characters in the character voice. And that was really, really challenging. And I was a little worried about going into that session because I had to try to mimic these other voices, which were really hard, but in this other character voice. So that would be probably really challenging.
Like a mask over a mask over a fursuit. They're out there!
Yeah, exactly.
They're heroes. They're sweaty, sweaty heroes.
Would you, you talked about having like a phrase to get into character. Would you use a different phrase for that? Or how do you get to that place? How do you do that?
How do I get to that place to be able to do that? For that one, I was familiar with the other actor's characters, so I was able to do it. And then there was one that I couldn't. I was like, and the actor was right there, of course, and I said, can you just read my line for me real quick? Like, in the session with all the microphones. And so the actor did. And then, and we set it up, the voice director set it up, that they would be recording. So they'd call the slate, and they'd be recording, and then the one actor would say the line, and I could just jump in right after, so they wouldn't do a slate to interrupt me, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Did his line and then Slade and then me to go. So then I was able to listen to him and we were already rolling and I could just jump right in and do it. And I did, I think, one take and they were like, yeah, great. So I just needed to hear it. So that was like a great technique. All right.
Nice.
Thank you.
That just about wraps us up. We're a little over 4:50, so we got a couple minutes left.
Okay.
Do you know anything else of your schedule, what you're doing this weekend?
I'm doing...
I think tomorrow's another autograph session.
Yes. A couple of autograph sessions and some comic book reading.
Ooh.
And then VIP mixing and banquet eating. Maybe.
How much higher would we go on this?
Maybe higher.
I walked into that. That was my own fault. Thank you so much for coming up for this.
Thank
I hope
you
had fun. Did you guys learn a lot? You guys had some fun? All right, guys. You want to know what's in here next? Check it up on the PonyCon app. I've been Uncle Yo, and welcome to his first time again, Mr. Kyle Rideout. Awesome.
Thank you.
great rest of your day. Okay.